Welcome to a bit of an unusual mathology video. It's meant to be a fun interlude slipped in between the usual crazy stuff that I inflict on you every couple of weeks. Bit of an experiment, see what you think. One of you recently asked me to explain a math script from a movie they just watched on YouTube. Okay, does this ring a bell? Have you seen this clip? Well, I wouldn't be surprised if you have. This clip has a staggering 40 million views. And quite a few people liked it too, 450,000 likes. Wow. And what's the clip about? Well, the clip shows Nathan, the main character in the movie X plus Y, solving a maths problem during an International Maths Olympiad training camp. The guy over there is the crazy maths coach, and this is Nathan. Anyway, amazing, isn't it? 40 million views of a clip showing a kid solving a maths problem. There's something else that I found amazing. Looking through the 18,000 or so comments, it's pretty clear that while a lot of viewers got something out of the clip, the vast majority neither understood the problem that Nathan is solving, nor Nathan's very pretty solution. So my main mission today is to give a nice explanation of what's going on in terms of the maths in this clip. It's actually all quite easy, fun, and pretty. Promise. Anyway, here's the clip again. Skip it if it's still fresh in your mind.
20 random cards are placed in a row, all face down. A move consists of turning a face down card face up and turning over the card immediately to the right. Show that no matter what the choice of cards to turn, this sequence of moves must terminate. Nathan, hiding in the back won't help you. Would you like to come up and show us?
So we need to look at the cards, not as cards, but as numbers. We can call face down cards 1, face up cards 0. And initially, it would be a sequence of ones. The cards are all face down, but after a while, it would look something like that. As we can see, that is a binary number. And a move that consists of turning a face down card face up and the card immediately to the right of it could be that a 1 followed by a 1 could turn into a 0 followed by a 0. That would look like that. Or it could be a 1 followed by a 0 turning into 0 followed by a 1. In either case, we can see that the number in binary is strictly decreasing.
And that means?
Which means that the sequence must terminate.
Because?
Because you can't keep taking away from a positive integer without it turning negative.
No, you can't. You definitely can't. Good work.
Everyone, good work.
Did you get it? No? Not a problem. Okay, let's make sense of what the maths coach is asking there. For this, we need a few face down cards laid out in a row. He says it's supposed to be 20 cards, but to build some feel for what's happening, let's just start with 8 cards which fit nicely on the screen. There, 8 face down cards. Okay, pick one of the face down cards and the card immediately to the right and turn both cards over. Pick another face down card. Okay, well, 6 to choose from. Let's go for this one, doesn't matter which. And let's again highlight the card immediately to the right and turn both cards over. Now the coach says that if you continue this way, no matter what face down cards we choose along the way, will eventually terminate with all cards facing up. Okay, let's keep picking and turning pairs of cards and see what happens. There, okay, choose another one, choose another one, there, maybe that one, and maybe that one, and okay, all face up as predicted. Now, why will we always eventually end up with all cards face up? Well, let me show you a really easy way to see this, a way that does not involve anything fancy. First, let's spool back a bit. Okay, at every step, we always first pick one of the face down cards and then the card immediately to the right. Now, there are basically two different cases. First case, both cards are face down. Turning over both cards gives two face up cards, and so overall, the number of face up cards increases, right? Second case. Here, the second card is face up. The overall effect of flipping those two cards over amounts to the face that the blue arrow is pointing at moving to the left. Nothing else changes. Have a look. There, turn over. Did you see the face move? Very cute. So on every move, either new faces show up or one face moves one step to the left. So what if we only move a face on every turn? Then this game would never terminate, right? Well, good point. However, it's pretty obvious that the faces cannot keep on moving left. Eventually, they're going to get stuck. Okay, let's have a look here. Let's just move those guys and see what happens, right? Move left, stuck. Move, 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 stuck. And this means that at this point or earlier, we have to turn new cards face up. Also, as long as there are face down cards, it's always possible to make a move, right? And so more and more face up cards are bound to appear until all cards are face up. Proof complete. That wasn't hard, was it? And no binary magic required. Actually, did you notice that both Nathan and I missed out on something little? Let's spool back one more time. I'm sure a lot of you will have noticed that little oversight. What if we pick the face down card on the far right? Now, there's no card on the right of the card we picked, and the coach's instructions don't immediately apply. What should we do? Now, if this had been a real Maths Olympiad class, somebody would definitely have picked up on this and asked, what should we do? 100% somebody would have picked up on that. Well, I'd say it's probably most natural to simply turn over that one card. What do you think? Anyway, if we interpret the rule like this, our argument keeps working, and so our proof is really complete. Great. And obviously this works for any number of cards. No matter what number of cards we start with, we'll end up with all cards face up. Very pretty, don't you think? But what about Nathan's solution? He somehow uses binary numbers. Isn't that way too complicated? Well, no, not at all, considering that for his clued up audience, binary numbers are really nothing special at all. In fact, for any maths person, Nathan's solution is also very natural and elegant. So let me also give you a bit of an explanation of Nathan's explanation. Nathan says that we need to look at the cards not as cards, but as numbers. We turn face down cards into ones and face up cards into zeros. Okay, now Nathan points out that we can think of the string of zeros and ones in front of us as a number in binary form. Actually, if you don't know what a binary number is, that's not a problem at all. Just think of what you see in front of you as a good old decimal number. So in this case, what we're looking at is just the number 10,011,010, right? Everything that Nathan says also works if we think of those strings of zeros and ones as decimal numbers. But now it's easy to see that if we make one of our moves, the number in front of us will get smaller, right? Faces appearing corresponds to ones being zapped in the number. Let me demonstrate there. Zap. And obviously we end up with a smaller number this way. On the other hand, with the second type of move, one of the faces moving left corresponds to one of the ones moving right. Let's have a look. There the one moves right. Again, a one moving right results in a smaller number. Pretty obvious, isn't it? And very nice. Then Nathan argues that because the value of the number in front of us is getting smaller on every move, eventually the number in front of us has to be equal to zero. And the number being equal to zero corresponds to all cards being face up. Proved again. What's nice about Nathan's argument is that it makes the proof essentially one glance. A positive integer that keeps getting smaller has to eventually hit zero. That's the simple gist of it. Anyway, let me know in the comments which of the two proofs you like better. The first one I showed you, or Nathan's digit-powered proof. Also, let me know what you think of having shorter interludes like this in between my usual Kurosawa-length mathology videos. Will be interesting. Now, Norman Doe, one of my colleagues at uni, pointed out that the problem in this clip is actually a simplified version of the first part of a problem that was shortlisted for the 2009 International Mathematical Olympiad. I link to the full problem and the solution in the description of this video. Check it out. Also very nice. Now, here's a little puzzle for you. Let's start with 10 cards face down and always turn over 2 face down cards. Then we'll be finished with all cards face up after 5 moves. Right? Let's have a look. There, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right? 5 moves. And that's also the absolute minimum number of moves to go from all cards face down to all cards face up. Here's your puzzle. What is the maximum number of moves to go from all face down to all face up? They would definitely have discussed this puzzle in Nathan's Math Olympiad class. Guaranteed. Anyway, also leave your answers in the comments. Now, if you like maths in the movies, check out the MMDB, the mathematical movie database that my friend Martin and I have been maintaining for gazillions of years. Among other things, it's got links to hundreds of maths movie clips for you to check out and to like to death. And if you are really keen, we've even written a whole book about math in the movies. And here is one more really nice bonus question from the movie X plus Y. This is the problem at the very end of the movie that really gets to Nathan. It's more challenging than the problem we just discussed, and it goes like this. Ready? Well, here we go. You've got a 4x4 grid and 4 colors. Now, color the gray squares with those 4 colors such that in all 2x2s in the grid, we've got all 4 colors. In the sample coloring over there, that's the case. There, all 4 colors. All 4 colors, da, da, check, tick, tick, yeah, that's it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, now what you're supposed to show is that whenever you have such a special coloring of our grid, the 4 corners of the grid are colored with all 4 colors, guaranteed. In fact, you're supposed to show that this is always the case for any special coloring of 4x4, 8x8, 12x12, and in general, 4n×4n grids. What a pretty insight, isn't it? Now, the first one to leave a valid proof in the comments wins one of my t-shirts in the Mathologer t-shirt shop. Your choice. I'll also put up an animated solution to this problem on Mathologer 2 in a week from now, together with the announcement of the winner of the t-shirt. And that's it for today. Hope you enjoyed this somewhat unusual Mathologer video.